now it's Dirk Helbling whom you all know because he's the organizer. He is a professor at ETH Zurich for computational social science.
So we are seeing a perfect storm of digital technologies that is reshaping the world. Suddenly there's cloud computing, there's big data, there's artificial intelligence and cognitive computing, there's robotics, there's the Internet of Things, there's virtual reality, and many more things. And each of these technologies has the potential to transform products, services, and business models, entire economic sectors and governments, the financial system, the economy, and society altogether. This will happen. The question is, how would we want the future to look like if we could reinvent it? Now, first of all, we need to talk about the challenges ahead. Unfortunately, we haven't solved our existential problems. There is climate change, there is a financial, economic, and spending crisis, which is big. Conflicts and war in many places of the world. There's mass migration, terrorism, and all of that seems to have one root cause, which is lack of sustainability. So we are overusing the resources of the world, that creates a lack of resources elsewhere, and as a result, that creates conflict and war, mass migration, terrorism, all these problems that are bothering us. This is the problem that needs to be fixed, because if you don't fix it, then at least 2.5 billion people would die. These are the predictions. And the United Nations is aware of this. That's why we have the UN Agenda 2030 aimed at sustainable development. Now, a couple of years back, a community in complexity, science and beyond, has come up with a visionary idea to address these issues. We want to create an open, value-oriented information system for the world. The Future ICT Project wanted to build a planetary nervous system collecting data about this world and then feed it into a living Earth simulator to be able to look into possible futures and a global participatory platform that would unleash the power of these technologies for everyone. And across all the activities, we wanted to pay attention to ethical issues. We created interdisciplinary communities all across the world, and new fields of science emerged, like data science, computational social science, global system science. 5 years later, DARPA is still referring to the documents produced at that time. So, still timely. Europe could have been leading in the world. Future ICT was the most favorite project, the most popular one, but it wasn't funded. Instead, something else happened. People were suggesting that democracy was an outdated technology. It was said that it created health, wealth, and happiness for billions of people, but now it was time to do something else. And so we recently had to publish this article in Scientific American asking, will democracy survive big data and artificial intelligence? Because governments around the world wanted to rule more efficiently. The dream came up to create something like a digital sector. And it was actually built. So, with all the data about this world, big data, data about all human activities, combined with the Internet of Things, with artificial intelligence that's expected to surpass human intelligence in about 20 years' time, with quantum computing and all this, it was attempted to build something like a digital crystal ball that could see anything that's happening in the world in real time and even predict the future to some extent. People like Chris Anderson suggested that if you just had enough data, the data would reveal the truth and tell us what we have to do. And then we would just have to do it like a benevolent dictator or like a wise king empowered by all this data. And as a result, technological totalitarianism resulted. So this is the situation that unfortunately we ended up in. Seems to be something like a combination of 1984 and Brave New World and the Circle. So we have mass surveillance and individual profiling. We have big nudging for behavioral manipulation. We have a citizen score, predictive policing and censorship. It's not fully in place, but it could be put into place at any point in time governments decide. So it seems like more than $100 billion were spent on mass surveillance tools. In the UK, at least 48 organizations are able to see all the links that we've clicked when you were browsing the internet, even if you were deleting the history. Companies as well know what they have been doing on the internet. All those cookies are recording what you're doing. And only 300 Facebook likes seem to be enough to know you better than your best friends and your partner. This is shocking, this is concerning, and this is dangerous because it allows to manipulate your emotions, your thinking, your opinions, and your behavior, and it's being used to market products more efficiently, and it's also being used in politics. The idea was that technology would make us behave healthier and environmental friendly, but in the end, the technology was also used to manipulate elections, democratic elections. Rigged. But this is not all. There's also the citizen score. So suppose that supercomputer came up with the big plan how to optimize the world. That would imply what you would have to do. And it would be suggested to you on your smartphone or through some other smart device. And if you don't do it, it would give you some minus points. So what happens here in this experiment performed in China is that everything you do or don't do would give you plus or minus points. It would influence your life. So depending on this, the interest rate of the loan would be higher or lower. You could get certain jobs or not. You could travel to certain countries or not. And if you think, oh, that's China, it could never happen to democracies, then unfortunately you're wrong, because in the UK, Snowden revealed this karma police program, and it turns out that even what you watch on the internet and the radio programs that you listen to will get you plus or minus points. And now suppose that resources get short, how would somebody decide who still gets these resources, who gets certain services or not? Well, maybe the citizen score would decide. It would also be possible, because there are all these digital doubles of all of you in the computer, to figure out who would start to be dissatisfied and protest, and they could be identified with predictive policing algorithms and put to prison even before you start demonstrating. Now that's the world that we could have in the future, and in fact we now also have increasing the censorship laws. Now there is a book that describes what could or would happen in such a world. So I strongly warn against it. I don't think it's a solution of our problems, it's an even bigger problem. And if you want to read a science fiction of this kind of digital future, then I recommend you to read IGA. So what is the problem? It's lack of flexibility. In these times we have to be more creative and more innovative, and that requires sufficient freedoms, right? It seems like our society has arrived at a crossroads, and we have to make up our minds how the digital future should look like. Of course, we can build different digital futures. It just depends on us. So I demand that we make sure that these data that have been collected about all of us would be democratically controlled, that they would be used by highly competent interdisciplinary teams in a scientific way and in an ethical way and transparent, and that misuse would be prevented. Nobody would feel comfortable if secret services or large corporations or private individuals could use this data to their liking. Rather, it seems like it's really important that data that is kept and operated outside of national and international law would actually benefit the public good, and this is the proposal that I'd like to make. We should create a network of digital labs, such as the MIT Media Lab could be a model. That means a network of data and complexity science hubs where those interdisciplinary teams of scientists would work in a transparent way for the benefit of humanity. We are entering a new time, because even though we have the best technology and more data than ever, we're losing control over the world as we try to control it in a top-down way. And the reason is, as we network the world, complexity increases even faster than the data volume. And we need a new control approach, which is distributed control, and in fact there is new technology that allows it. We can build decentralized autonomous organizations now with blockchain technology, and everyone would be enabled to create organizations for purpose. Now, complex systems that have been created have special features. They self-organize. If the interactions are right, then efficient and favorable, desirable outcomes result. Well, if the interactions are wrongly designed, then you would get a big mess. You would, for example, have cascading effects that could create global scale trouble, as we have seen that actually during the financial crisis. So, what do we need to do? I think we need to build a resilient society that would be able to flexibly respond to surprises and challenges. Subsidiarity, diversity, distributed control seem to be the right approaches to prepare ourselves. I don't believe that large corporations would fix the world, because the approach is that you would look for the optimal solution to a problem and then you scale it up to the entire world and run that business model for 30 years while a better solution may be just around the corner. This is not the world we want to live in. It's more this kind of world, a diverse and colorful world, and requires a new kind of governance where politics and business and citizens and scientists sit at one table. Now, I believe that we need to upgrade democracy in a digital way. This is about bringing the knowledge and ideas of many minds together, to put it all on one table and organize it into different perspectives that would then be integrated through innovative solutions that would be created at a round table. So it's not about a small majority ruling about all of society, but it's really about creating collective intelligence, because it's not the best single idea that turns out to be the best, but the combination of solutions in a complex world. In fact, there are new incentive systems that can boost that collective intelligence. Now, self-organization, on the other hand, can be supported by digital assistants. People should be able to turn it on and off to set the goals, and then they would get the support they're asking for. And that could be applied to so many different areas of life, And we started actually to work on such platforms. NervousNet is one of them, inspired by Future ICT, where we are using smartphones and the sensors in them to build a global measurement system. And the idea is to build a real-time feedback and thereby make self-organization, or the invisible hand of Adam Smith, finally work. And we have shown that actually for traffic control, it's possible to dissolve traffic jams with a distributed control approach. And the principle is to create real-time feedbacks and modify the interactions through mechanism design in such a way that self-organization would produce desirable outcomes. We've also demonstrated that actually for urban traffic flow, where green waves can self-organize, if we let the traffic jams control the traffic lights in the bottom-up way rather than the other way around, it's much more efficient than those centralized control attempts of today, and much better for the environment. Now, I started with sustainability. That's the biggest problem. And in fact, every human being in industrialized societies produce 50 tons of waste in a lifetime. These are many cars, computers, TV sets, sofas, and everything. So enough stuff for at least 5 people. So it's clear what we need to do. We need to build a circular economy, a sharing economy. Then resources will be enough for everyone. Nobody has to die. But how to get there? We have to measure externalities like noise and CO2 and stress and all the waste that we are producing. And positive things too, such as cooperation, health, education, the reuse of resources. And then we would want to increase the positive externalities and reduce negative ones. That can be done through a multidimensional incentive system that can now be built with blockchain technology. That would basically make the reuse of waste attractive and make sure that the financial system would support the societal values. That means environmental friendly and socially responsible production would earn you something. It wouldn't be costly as today. We call that value-sensitive design. It's now possible, but we should also boost co-creation. The idea is that everyone is taking better decisions, is more creative, more innovative, it's easier to cooperate, then this will create a better future, of course. And we could build on combinatorial innovation that just requires sufficient interoperability and openness. So we could build an innovation, production, and service ecosystem where everyone could contribute. And in fact, this is on the way. There's open innovation around the globe, at Fab Labs, hundreds of them around the world. And I think we could also add another instrument that I call City Olympics, where cities of the world would compete for the best energy efficient solutions, for the best climate saving solutions, for the best environmental solutions, and then every second year they would exchange the best solutions with each other. I think that would really make dramatic progress in a short time. And finally, I think we really need to boost innovation. How to do that? Well, today we have a financial system that's producing booms and crashes since 5,000 years, and we're again in big, big trouble. In fact, inequality has become even an obstacle to economic development. What we're doing today is we're pumping trillions into the financial system in a top-down way. Keyword is quantitative easing. It hasn't worked well, really. So why don't we try something else and pump it in a bottom-up way, and namely go from venture capitalism, where just a few people decide about the innovations of the future, to crowdfunding, which has been invented because it didn't work so well, and filling a gap towards crowdfunding for everyone, And I call that democratic capitalism, where that money that would be pumped into the system bottom up would be an investment premium that you couldn't keep for yourself, but you were supposed to give to people who have great ideas, who want to build new technology, who want to engage and are engaging for society and the environment. And in this way, we could all make a much bigger contribution to our society, and we could mobilize the wisdom of crowds. So I think the world is in big trouble, but there are solutions. We can make it. If we do what I proposed, I'm convinced we can all live in an age of prosperity and peace. And so let's do this together now. Thank you.